Click the link in the description for your free Amsoil catalog. Before we get started, I'd like to give a quick shout out to some of our friends. The Eastern Snowmobile Racing Hall of Fame. Search for them on Facebook. Central Minnesota Pond Racing. Search for them on Facebook. The historic Lancaster Motel for the ultimate Eastern trail riding adventure. Crane's Snowmobile Museum at 172 Main Street in Lancaster, New Hampshire. The Vintage Snowmobile Club of America Quarterly Magazine. The New Hampshire Snowmobile Museum at Bear Brook State Park in Allenstown, New Hampshire. And lastly, if you decide to advertise with the Vintage Snowmobile Podcast, this could be your advertising message. Good evening and welcome to the season finale of the Vintage Snowmobile Podcast. Now, unfortunately, we had to put off the season finale for a few weeks. We usually like to wrap it up by the end of March, but there's just too much going on working against us. So we're doing it now. Better late than never. So a little bit of housekeeping before we get started. I want to make sure that everything is working properly. So if you can see my face and hear my voice, I'm going to ask you to leave a message. Please let me know where you're viewing this from and whether you are a first-time viewer or a regular viewer. Now, to our first-time viewers, if this is your first time hanging out with us tonight, I hope you have a good time, and I hope you decide to join us here each and every Thursday night at 9 p.m. Eastern Time. Now, you heard me talking about season finale. Yes, we are wrapping up the season tonight, but in this time slot, all through the summer months, we're airing replays. So there's going to be something here for you each and every Thursday night at 9 p.m. Eastern Time. So wherever you're viewing this right now, this podcast simulcast to 8 different places across Facebook and YouTube. So wherever you're viewing right now, just circle back in 1 week's time, and there will be a replay waiting for you with some nice Vintage Snowmobile entertainment. Now, to our regular viewers who are here week after week, month after month, and season after season, you guys are the ones who make this possible, and we very much appreciate that. We've got a flood of comments coming in. Let's take a few, and then we'll get started. Let's see. Jeffrey Patton is in the house. Good evening, Mike and Rob. Regular viewer from Pennsylvania. Thank you, Jeffrey, for coming on. I know you've been a very regular viewer this season. We very much appreciate that. Brad Ketzler says the 6500 Blizzard is amazing. Yes, it most certainly is. And thank you for being here tonight. My good friend John Spranger Jr. is in the house. Good evening, everyone, from Elon, Wisconsin. Very cool. Mad Dog, greetings from Wisconsin. Regular viewer. Nice to see you, Mad Dog. Let's see. Alan Gove from New Hampshire. Regular viewer. Nice to have you in the house. My good friend Mike Whiteside is here. Good evening, fellas. Not ready for the last live podcast of the year. Have a great show. Well, cool. I know what you mean. It's flown right by. It's sad to see it come to an end, but yeah, it's time to move on to summer things. So let me switch gears here. We'll continue to put these comments on the screen, but I want to bring our friends on and get the party started. And we have our co-host, Rob Hilditch, in the center. And, of course, our guest who's been on here many times, our guest and good friend, Jim Leighton. Jim, how are you doing tonight?
Wonderful. Wonderful. Thanks for having me on.
Oh, for sure. For sure. Great to see you. Now, Jim, for the people who may have not be familiar with you, where are you here? Where are you located tonight?
Tonight, I'm in Caribou. I'm out back of the new bowling alley center that's here. My buddy's got a host of all kinds of different vintage snowmobiles that started a collection, I don't know, maybe 10 years ago. So, you know, I had a bowling game tonight and figured I'd just come out back here so we could show some videos and maybe show off a few more of these old sleds.
Perfect, perfect. In fact, let's start with the live show and tell if you're okay with that, and then we'll get to the videos. And we've got a bunch of other things, too, we're going to look at tonight. But, yeah, I can't wait to see what you've got in there. I always love the show and tell, and I think our viewers do, too.
All right. Let me switch the camera around. I'm sure that – oops. That
sure thing.
Off. And I need to – all right. It's a lot to switching this thing around here.
Sure. It's all good. And once you've got it switched around, I'll put you full screen. There we go. Let me put you full screen. There we go. Wow, we've got a lot of cats up there.
So we'll start on this wall. There's some old moto skis on the top. Couple old orange and white cats there. Those were some of the vintage single cylinder cats that he built. Some of the younger guys raced in Turner at the Turner 100 Lunger, and so we had those built for that. Played with that a little bit. That was fun. And then there's a lot of old moto ski or snow jet stuff here.
Yeah, different very bucks, nice. Different models. Took a couple of SSPs in there.
There's another one over here. Kawasaki. And then there's this Kawasaki Drifter.
Yeah.
Hanging out. 65 Olympic. And there's a Mercury. Snow Twister. That Mercury Snow Twister, I can't remember where he picked it up at, but that actually has some race history in Eagle River.
Yeah, Eagle River, no less.
Yeah, so that's a few of those here. And let's go over here. It might get a little bit darker, but.
Sure.
There's a couple of Alpines. This is a pretty cool old Skarul.
Yeah.
I took that out for a ride this winter at one of the shows. It was really, runs really good.
Nice. So it looks like it's in nice shape. Yeah.
It is in good shape. Yeah. The drive cogs in the front dry rotted, and we got to pull them off and change them, but the thing runs really, really well.
Wow.
So there's that's got this 292 is, I think it's got like 126 miles on it.
Wow.
Not like nothing for miles on it.
Yeah, very nice.
So you got to forgive the dust because we just haven't had time to do anything for cleaning out here. And obviously there's construction equipment everywhere.
Sure.
So anyway, this RUP, I haven't had a chance to really take a really good look at it. And we try it or anything, but that's the heat exchanger on the front.
With a bumper, yeah.
Yeah, from what I understand. Again, I don't know a lot about RUPs. I'm more of a Ski-Doo guy, but that's a really cool sled.
Sure.
So, all three of the Silver Bullets are here.
Yeah.
All three models are here for the Silver Bullets.
Oh, yes. Yeah, on the bottom row there, the other two. Yep. Yeah.
The other two there. So, these two cats are kind of one of the guys from one mechanic around here. Took some Polaris sleds apart, and the tracks and the skis made the suspension on these, and they ride really well. They really
That's
do.
That's amazing.
So they're just single cylinders, but they've got the ride to them for sure.
That's going to be fun.
Yeah,
and I'll bet they get some double takes when you get them out on the trail or at shows.
When we were riding them on the trails there a few years ago, they would definitely. So nice old Articat here. We got, I would try to 12-3. There's a nice little Polaris here.
Yeah, a nice little Colt.
So those are the two other Silver Bullets. And then we'll walk down a little further. This right here, this 68 right here, that was purchased out of a museum in Michigan.
Michigan, yeah.
Had it shipped here with this little tow along.
Yeah.
A little Mark One. It was in a museum in Michigan. Runs really, really well. Nice little machine. 1968.
Yeah, nice. Very nice.
Oh. Just loads of Olympics.
Yeah. The old iconic bubble nose.
Iconic bubble nose. Yeah, there's the skunk.
Yeah.
That's a 292.
Pepe Le Pew.
Yeah.
Yeah, nice.
That's that Salt Lake edition, 2002.
What makes that a Salt Lake edition? Does it have a longer track or something?
It was the It was an addition that they built that put together that year
for the Olympics.
So
now that you mention it, I do remember that. But go ahead.
Yeah. Got a land here. I saw a land here. That was the very first sled that picked up for single cylinder racing. Bought that out of Keene, New Hampshire.
Yeah.
Little 292. Somebody built it down there. Runs really well. So we've got a 669 here, 1969 TNT.
Yeah.
I got a couple covers on here, but I'll pull these out just to, it won't take me long to pull the cover off. I apologize.
Sure.
This is a 71 440 Blizzard. This Blizzard was commissioned and built with Tom Peters.
Tom Peters, yes, I know Tom.
Yep.
He was inducted into the Eastern Snowmobile Racing Hall of Fame, I believe, in the year 2020.
Yeah. So Tom got this sled from a friend of ours in Bangor. His name was Toby Williams. It wasn't in this good a shape, but he brought it home, and he got a bunch of people to restore it, and this thing is just mint. We've never run it. Never had gas in it. But it's all brand new.
Wonderful.
That's a 71 440 Blizzard.
And that's as it was as he raced it? He raced it pretty much
spec? Raced one like this, yeah.
Like that, okay.
Yeah.
And it's pretty close to the spec that he had that he raced?
Probably, yeah.
Yeah, very nice.
Yeah. So I'll put my thing on the old and pull some cover off in this one here.
Yeah.
This one, this Articat here that I'm going to show you is pretty cool because Articat in 1970 only made three of these. And they only made one of them as a mod in the factory. And this is the one, 793 Puma.
Wow.
Triple. So got the exhaust coming right out the front.
Straight down, yeah. I bet that crackles.
Well, I haven't had a chance it was built for racing, it doesn't have a recoil on it.
Oh, wow, yeah.
So you got to wrap the rope. So I've messed with it a little bit. I got it to fire, but not actually up and run to hear it really go. So,
yeah.
But we'll get a chance to do that at some point.
If you ever do, I'd love to see a video of that.
Oh, yeah. We'll video it for sure.
Yeah.
For sure. So that's kind of, you know, those are a couple of cool race sleds right there.
Yeah, that's something we can look forward to in the next season.
Yeah. Yeah, pull them out and go. So I don't know how many people have seen this before, because it was the first one that I've ever seen. And it's a Mercury. You know, it's a little toboggan, pull behind toboggan, made by Mercury.
Is that a metal flake?
That's a metal flake. Yeah, I don't know if I call it metal flake because it looks like it's
a splatter.
It looks like it's splattered paint.
Sure, yeah.
Like splattered white paint on top of fiberglass, top of red, you know. So I don't know if anybody's ever
seen. Is this something you sit half a dozen kids in there and pull them along?
Yeah, I guess so. It's huge.
Very cool.
I don't know if anybody's ever seen one and know what year it is, or if there's, you know. It's pretty neat.
Yeah.
So that's, you know, besides getting into the weeds of some of the other, you know, I'll catch a few things here. Of course, and there's always stuff like this laying around, right?
Yeah.
You always got the parts sled. Somebody's got, you can't let it die. You just got to bring it.
Sure. Someone will use parts off of that.
Yeah. There's enough of those, as you can see, like, you know, down in here.
Yes, yeah. The Polaris back there, and yeah.
You know, there's that stuff is always laying around, so it's, you know, but you can't let it go.
No. No.
So yeah, that's kind of what we got here.
Very cool. Now, Rob, did you have questions on any of this before we switch gears?
Oh, I like the idea of having a sleigh with the snowmobiles. Not too many people have sleighs that match, and I've never seen the Mercury one before.
True, yeah, same here.
And I like that skidoo he's got right there, 780.
That's a 700 triple, yeah.
700, yep.
Yeah.
Formula Deluxe. Cool. I got the same machine, but a 670.
Okay. Grand Touring 700. Suspension. Big Bearcat in the back. That thing has got tracks on it, long, bigger than my feet.
Yeah, look at that. Serious flotation with that. Crazy.
And this sled back here was the first sled that I talked him into buying and said, just get one so we can go vintage riding. And that was a sled like his grandfather had, so he bought that. And it ended up snowballing into all the rest of the stuff.
Nice.
What's the total number of machines you have?
I started counting them and putting them in an Excel spreadsheet with all the parts and stuff, and then life got in the way, and I haven't got back to it yet.
Turn to the left. What's that yellow one right there? Right there. Yellow.
Right here?
The old Skidoo.
This one here?
66?
This is a 65.
65.
Nice. 65, yeah, Olympic.
What a great collection.
Yeah.
For sure.
Most people only collect one brand. You guys got everything.
We've got everything here, yeah.
Nice mix.
I've got a 66S with the dual carburetors at home, and then a 64. So, and then there's a 1970. There's a 1970 Alpine that's missing here too. It's in one of the trailers.
Okay. Wow, very cool.
You mean you're missing one? You notice it?
Yeah. Yeah. There should be four Alpines here, and there's only three.
Wow.
There's the 67 hiding back in the corner. Somebody.
Oh yeah, it. Yeah, under the stuff there.
Yeah.
Nice.
Usually what happens, right?
Oh yeah. Well, cool. So, we are just getting started. We've got video clips.
Anybody want to see something close up or closer up or?
Yeah, if anyone's got something specific they'd like to see, leave a message in the comment here real quick, because we're about to shift gears. We're just getting started. We've got a whole mess of video clips we're going to look at. And yeah, we've got a whole evening to look ahead to here. But if anyone's got anything they'd like a closer look at, leave a message in the comments here right away. And we'll get a close-up on it for you. And then we're going to switch gears with some video clips. And oh, here we go. We've got a couple of comments coming in. Here we go. Another look at that 71 cat, please. And Keith Jash says that.
Oh, the cat. The Puma.
Must be that triple he's talking about.
Okay, let's take a walk.
That was what, a 793 or something?
Yeah, 793.
Yeah, that was sweet.
Puma. It was done just before they did the King Cats.
So it was kind of like a testing a concept for it?
Yeah. Yeah, I think. I don't know a whole lot of the history on it besides, you know, I just read a little bit of it online. So there's that right there.
There we go.
So is the serial number for that 001?
You know, that's a good question. I don't. If you look up the 70 Puma 793 online, it'll show three sleds, production of three. And that'll show one as a mod. So
that's rare.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. To see a triple that size in a Puma. Yeah. And then Reese Fleury is asking, do you have any Snowjet SSTs for sale?
Oh, I can tell you, Reese, there's nothing for sale here. He won't sell anything. So
they're all keepers.
They're all keepers.
Yeah.
Yes. And anyone who's a collector.
If Reese has one for sale, he might buy it off him.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. He just might.
Nice. Nice.
That's a great collection.
And then Reese is saying darn as far as that none of those are for sale.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. That's wild. Well, cool.
The plan is to get this place tidied up a lot, get a few more shelves. Get this stuff set up, cleaned up on the shelves. So this dust here is all from construction of the building for the last, you know, the few years of in construction. So we can do that and set this up and bring these around kind of down this wall as well, and get everything all in the kind of one corner. We'll turn it more into a, so it's easier for people to come view them. Because a lot of people will come to the restaurant and they'll be like, hey, I heard there's some sleds out back. I want to go see. And usually there's somebody around that'll bring them out and show them.
Nice. That would be cool.
Yeah.
So I would want to dine at a place like that.
Yeah.
And I'm sure everyone viewing this would want to dine at a place like that.
Yeah. Yeah. Beautiful here. He did a beautiful job up front. So.
Yeah. This is awesome. Well, cool. So we've got some video clips to look at. Okay. Let me change screens here and see what we've got. We've got some video clips that you sent me, and then I've got some clips that some other people have sent me. This clip we're about to look at, I believe, is at a show you attended in February, and I think you're one of the organizers of this show. Do I understand that correctly?
Did I lose you?
Yeah, we're still here. Can you hear us?
Okay, yeah.
So this is a clip from a February show that you sent us, and I'm wondering, are you one of the organizers of this show?
No, I was just involved in bringing some sleds to it.
Gotcha. All right. Yeah. Well, let's take a look at it, and then we'll react to it on the other side.
Okay, hold on here. I've lost a...
Whoops, sorry. We'll be right back. yeah, thank you to Jim Leighton for that awesome footage. And Jim, this ski rule, is that the one we were just looking at a few minutes ago?
Yep.
Nice. All right. And what can you tell us about this show, Jim?
So this show was put together by the Snowmobile Club in Frenchville, way up north. Just to, you know, they raised money for the Snowmobile Club. So they put a really nice show together, and there's a, you know, as you can see, for, you know, sled a little club way up north, they pull together a lot of snowmobiles. So we did a little bit of a tour around the backyard with the sleds and come back. That was it. We didn't really go very far. They had a nice little cookout and showed off quite a few sleds.
Yeah, it looks like a nice selection there. Now, Rob, was there anything that caught your eye as we were going by there?
The very first one, I didn't know what it was. It was a red one, right at the very first.
Let me see if I can find it.
Very first machine.
Is that a Rupp?
This one? You talk about this one here or the Snow Dog?
I don't think that was it.
No, looking at the one with the that you sat down inside of.
Oh, that metal, that like aluminum looking one? Yeah. Right there, I just had it.
One of those snow bodies looked like they'd be fun to drive.
Right there, I think what that's called is a snow bug.
Yeah,
I remember right. It'd be fun to take for a ride.
That
trying to get a closer look at it, but it's hard to.
You might get a. We might. There'll probably be a better picture of it at the next show if you did the Prescott show too.
Oh, good. Here's a good shot of it.
Yeah,
I'm surprised the amount of race machines they had at that show.
Yeah.
I like that purple EXT. That was beautiful.
Yeah. Rob, I'm surprised you didn't comment on the 64 with all the big Amsoil sticker on it.
Yeah. I see two of them with them.
That was cool. Let me try to find that. It was near the end there. Yeah right down this road here, right there.
Yeah. Go ahead. There was one just before that with the big Amsoil sticker on it, a black Skidoo. Just back about four more.
Oh, up a little, yeah.
Oh, I think I missed it.
Yeah.
But
I got one of those little toboggans.
Yeah. There's
what are you gonna do with it?
That's a that Blizzard right there. That's an original Blizzard in the condition that it can't get done racing out of a company in New York. It's a 340 single cylinder bubble nose Blizzard.
Nice.
That's the exact condition that it was done with when they got done racing it, and the thing runs great.
Wow. Nice.
Not that one, the one next to it, obviously. The one you.
Sure. Yeah. And I like that RV. Oh, this one here, the Kiefer with a Kiefer helmet on.
Right.
Yeah, right there. And I like that cross country RV there on the left.
Yeah. Yeah, that was Kiefer's as well.
Nice. Now, Alan Gove from New Hampshire is asking, what's the name of the restaurant where all those sleds are where you are right now?
It's called the Evergreens. Well, it's called the Evergreen Bowling Lane, featuring the Rendezvous Restaurant. So it's the Rendezvous Restaurant in Caribou with a bowling alley attached to it. The old bowling alley that used to be on Loring Air Force Base was called Evergreen Bowling, and it was large ball.
What's the name of the town, Jim?
What's that?
What's the name of the town?
It's in Caribou right now. Yeah.
Caribou, Maine.
It used to be on Loring, which was in Limestone, the bowling alley. And the Rendezvous Restaurant was just outside the gate of the Air Force Base. And they both closed down. So he just took the, you know, he was able to purchase the stuff from both of them and make this one big building. So it's in Caribou, Maine. And it's the Rendezvous Restaurant.
Nice. Nice. Well, cool. Let me set up our shot here. There we go. So we're just getting started. We've got plenty more video clips to look at, but before we do, it's time for us to do Amsoil, since we were just looking at that sled with a big Amsoil sticker on there. And Rob, if you're ready, I'll put you full screen. And I've also got that video clip you were mentioning earlier.
Okay. We've talked a number of times about the Amsoil products and how you can get the catalog from Amsoil and how you can get the best possible discount. And this time of year, if you're putting your snow machines and stuff like that away, don't forget Amsoil has fogging oils, the quick shot for the ethanol problems. It's especially if you're bringing lawnmowers and chainsaws out. But Amsoil just had an article they printed by a third-party company, did a test on their stabilizer, and it's 86% more efficient than, what's the other one called? I forget the name of it.
Seafoam?
But we have all the products available. So if you can get the catalog from Mike, but a lot of people were asking, how do I know what product I need? So we're going to play a little video that shows you how to look up exactly what product you need for your vehicle. Doesn't matter if it's a car, motorcycle, an ATV. You can click on the Amsoil site, look up your vehicle. Let's see the video, Mike.
Yes, let me find that. This thing is not cooperating. Hold on 1 second. Someone. There we go, my Jeopardy music. Yes, thank you, because I'm having a slight technical problem. Oh, this is aggravating. But I do have it. I just...
This is a video Amsoil put out a couple weeks ago, and it's one of the promotion shows that Amsoil was showing, and they're showing people how to look up your VIN number to know what oil filter. Oh, here it goes. It's only there 2 minutes long.
Board there, you can look through and see it, or in the door jam. But there's a lot to it. There's a lot going on in the VIN. You can see it all starts over here, but there's two places I want to look at. The 8-digit, that's the engine type that's important. You could have a 3.4 dual overhead cam, or you can have a 3.4 cam and block. So you want to look there to decipher what your engine is, and the 10th digit represents the year. And you can see here, your 10th digit can go all the way through the alphabet numerically and start all over again. And you can tell exactly what year it is. But Len, Amsoil made it even easier. Can you navigate and show us about our specific vehicle?
We sure can. Let's pick a vehicle here today. We'll just take a look. Let's just pick a random popular vehicle because we've got a tab right on our website. You click on it, it's going to ask you to enter the vehicle. So you could put in anything from a light truck, a car, motorcycles, ATV, UTV. We've got it all on there. So for today's purposes, we'll pick an auto light truck. Let's pick a later model. How about a 19? We'll pick a Chevy. And then we'll go ahead and let's pick a pickup truck with a 5.3 liter engine. And what'll happen is it actually pulls up the entire product line for this vehicle. So any of the oils that'll work, it has the quantities available, and then it also allows you to build a kit. So we've got a virtual kit there as well. So if you want a filter, you want the right amount of oil, you just click kit.
Now this is huge. So we're not going back and forth to the auto parts store. Oh, I forgot this, I forgot that. Everything's there. What's actually located in the kit?
The kit will contain all the oil it needs. So you pick the type of oil that you want from our signature series, our high mileage oil, any one of the oils you can pick that works in this vehicle. You go ahead and click on it. The filter, everything is there that you need. Now, if you want to go further, you can click on the transmission and we can find out what transmission it has, what products that we're looking for, and you can add it to your cart right from there. Very simple. Scroll a little bit further. Well, what do you know? There's your differential that pops up. Transfer case, it's all there. We figured make it as easy as you possibly can to get that product in the customer's hands.
Wow, bam, just that easy. You go to amsoil.com and try it out for yourself.
That's a good little video. And I have a lot of personal small garages that uses that. Because say you got a, like he said, a 1980 Chevy pickup, and you want to know how much the rear end fluid is, you can go on that site within 2 minutes, find out what fluid it takes, whether it's a 75W90, a 110, or a 75-140, and how much fluid it takes. Less than a minute, you can look it up. Some of the other sites, it takes hours to look up how much fluid exactly needs. It's a great, easy site, and it tells you what products are available for your vehicle. So get your best possible discount. You can become a preferred customer, hook up with Mike, buy the oil directly from Amsoil, save 25%, have it shipped right to your house.
Yes, just click the link in the description. That way Rob and I will get credit for it. I'm signed up as an Amsoil dealer under Rob. So when you order through us, we both get credit for it. And the commissions I make are what we use to offset the cost of doing this podcast. And we thank everyone who's been doing that and thank anyone who considers doing that. We've got a question that's come in. Mad Dog is wondering if you can buy the Amsoil poster that's in the background. And I'll open this up so people can get a better look at that.
Not available anymore.
Oh, wow. So that's an older one. Vintage. Sweet.
They're all vintage.
Very cool. Nice.
Is Jim going to get us a hamburger?
I don't know, but Ben Thomas is saying road trip to the rendezvous. Very cool. Very cool. So we're going to mix it up a bit. I've got some more videos from Jim, but I've also got videos from a few others as well. So let's take a look. In fact, Ben, who was just making comments, his son, Eric, made a video recently of a Ski-Doo Alpine. And this is on his YouTube channel called Benedim. So I'm going to pull that up and we'll take a look at that video. And then we'll come back to some videos from Jim. So let's pull this up here. You guys can see that all right?
Hashtag Alpine problems.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much to Eric Benedetto. That's his YouTube channel. If you like what you saw there, he's got a whole lot more videos. Just search for Benedim on YouTube and you'll find his channel. There's lots of nice videos there. But so thank you so much to Eric for that. We appreciate that. And any comments on that, what we were just looking at? Or
Jim, have you taken an Alpine out for a drive before?
Oh, yes. Yeah, the 70 Alpine that's here that we have here is my favorite.
What do you do when you get it stuck?
Well,
that's my question.
I don't.
You get it if you got it stuck.
Yeah, I know it. It's got reverse, but that don't help you when you get stuck in an Alpine. Cool. That just gets it worse. But usually if we go out for a vintage ride, I like to take the Alpine. It's electric start. It sits up high. I hook the skiboose onto it. So everything that gets loaded in there, all the food, all the drinks, right? It's all loaded in there and I'm hauling. I may be the slowest guy out on the trail, but they don't leave me behind.
You get all the food.
I love it. I love it. I really don't like getting it out into the softer snow because it just turns so hard, you know, sure. Where you can see this one here when he was riding it on the packed snow turned pretty good, you know?
Yeah. So. Yeah. But it was in the loose snow. He had the handlebar turn as far as it could.
Yep. Yep. They just don't turn.
Yeah. Got to keep a good carbide on that. Yeah. Well, cool. Cool. Yeah. We've got plenty more to look at. We've got some more video clips from Jim. In fact, let me cue one up here. This is from another show. This is one from last month. So let's take a look at this and then we'll discuss it on the other side. And it's just taking a moment to load. Need some Jeopardy music. Here we go. Here it comes. Yeah, thank you so much to Jim Leighton for that footage. And Jim, where was this show?
So this show was in Presque Isle.
Presque Isle.
Yeah, we had a snow bowl here, and it was supposed to be in Caribou at the Spud Speedway, the racetrack in Caribou. And of course, we lost snow like crazy, and they switched gears like literally overnight and went to the mall and asked the owner if they could use the parking lot, and they just hauled in 300 loads of snow and built a track for the snowcross, and we organized the vintage show to put there, and it was fun.
Wonderful. And I think you sent me footage of them racing in that snow.
Yeah probably did,
which we'll look at a little bit later.
Yeah,
but was this your father's race sled? Do I understand that?
Yeah, so my dad bought this sled. It's a 1971 797 Blizzard. So he bought that brand new, raced it, you know, over a couple of years, blew the motor and the crank as a 71 would in the center crank. And it just kind of sat out back and forever until our friends, the Kiefer family, came along and they grabbed onto it and they restored it. So this sled here is was purchased by my father brand new in 71. What'd they make? 120 something of them or something like that.
Yeah.
And it's really never left his possession, right? It's never been sold off. He owns his original. He's 95 years old, and he owns, you know, this is the original sled that he bought and raced.
That's amazing.
So one of the questions I was going to ask you is, at the beginning you showed you had that background of there was a 440 Blizzard with there you go. So that sled there was my father didn't buy it brand new. He bought it in 74 used. It was raced in Canada 1 year, and then he bought it in 74. That's a 73 Blizzard, and that was restored by the Kiefer family. And I'm not sure where it's at. I've heard rumors that it was in the Crane Museum, but I don't know.
Oh, could be. I don't recall seeing it, but that doesn't mean it's not there.
Yeah,
things rotate out in and out of there. I can keep an eye out for it next time I'm there.
Yeah, I didn't know if it was there or if it was somewhere else in Wisconsin or who knows, right? Once they get sold, they're gone. So
sure.
So those three sleds right there, that Blizzard, the Black Dot, and the Olympic next to it are the three that I brought. And then
excellent.
Had a lot of really nice ones. Not that you can see it, but across the street, I had my little kitty cat over there. And there was a couple of nice Polaris's. I thought that I had them in the video, but I guess I didn't.
Sure. Now, Rob, did anything catch your eye in here? There's that snowbug
there
again.
There's a lot of nice machines there. But, Jim, does your restaurant ever do a snowmobile show?
We haven't yet, no. No, haven't done anything like that. Just, you know, winters are so busy. And
those skidoos right there, Jim, what year did skidoo go to metal skis? Like, that's a 65 or 64 skidoo, isn't
that?
That's
a 64. So what was it, 60?
Early 60s.
They only had wooden skis, I think, 1 year or even maybe even a half a year.
Like 62 or 63, really early.
Yeah, tin cab, like the original tin cab, 62, 63, something like that.
Sure.
A friend of mine in Presque Isle has one. He has the wooden ski tin cab. He's got a really nice collection of sleds like this, all bombardier stuff like this. Nice. Really, they're all kind of like here. They're all kind of rider quality stuff. You know what I mean? They look really good, but you don't mind taking them out and going for a ride with them.
And the Crane Museum in Lancaster has one with the wooden skis.
Yeah.
And actually, I'm forgetting something. I promised my good friend Josh Leverker I would give a shout out to an event he's putting on. And I know he's watching tonight and maybe wondering why I forgot that. So apologies to Josh, but here we go. May 25th in Lowville, New York. Josh and Ed Stab are putting on a big show. Very much worth a look because they organize, both of them, Josh and Ed, organize great shows. So it's you know it's quality when those two guys are involved. So I wanted to make sure and give a shout out to Josh as well as to his show.
Nice.
But yeah, we've got plenty more to look at here. So let me switch screens. Now, I've also got some footage sent to us by regular viewer. He goes by the name of Midnight Rider. He sent us some clips. So I'm going to go back and forth between your clips, Jim, and his clips.
Yep.
We'll kind of mix it up the rest of the show. But he sent us some clips for some shows he's been going to. Let me pull that up here. And I believe this is a photo montage. He sent me some photos. I put them into a little montage with some music. Let's take a look. So thank you to Midnight Rider. These are his Viking sleds, by the way. And gentlemen, reactions to what we've been looking at?
Pretty neat stuff there. That's just so many different sleds in the world back then.
Yeah, for sure. Nice drag sled there, too.
Yeah.
I think that was an oval racer, Mike.
Oh, is it? Yeah, yeah, I think you're right.
The bent down handlebar in the passenger and the left-hand side.
Yeah.
Got better eyesight than me. Yeah.
Yeah, me too.
and I've seen that. I've seen that boat before with the snowmobile in it. It looks pretty cool.
Yeah. What's the story with that? Is that just for show, or would that actually float if you took that in the water?
They made it to go take people out of the sunk their machines. That's really the article I read about.
That's amazing. That is amazing. And I had mentioned earlier this was going to be a photo montage. I was mistaken. This was obviously some video footage. But yeah, thank you so much to Midnight Rider for sending us that. We've got comments coming in. Where are we here? Eric Benedetto says, nice. Alpine, that was his footage earlier, by the way. Ben Thomas says, as Jim observed, Reese, they turn much, much better on hard pack base, talking about the Alpines. The show videos from Jim really highlighted some excellent snowmobiles. It's really impressive to see that many different brands in one show. His dad's 71 797 is his favorite. Awesome history right there. And Reese Fleury is commenting. I think he's talking about the year with the wooden skis on the Ski-Doos, 61. And maybe it changed mid-year. It might be what he's telling us. Ben Thomas says Northern New York Vintage Sled Show. Yes, that's coming up. And that was the graphic we were looking at before. Reese Fleury says, who's going to the Leighton Show? That's also in upstate New York. Ben Thomas says, Reese, the North Shore Vintage Sleds group will be there. That is a very active group, and they are very active in this podcast, and we appreciate that. Dave Trim says he's going to be at the Leighton Show as well. Very cool. So let me pull this down because we've got so much more to look at. We're just getting started. I've got some more footage from Jim now. Let's take a look. Yes, here's another one from March. This is a photo montage. I put some music under it. And this is from Jim Leighton, by the way. Yeah, thank you so much to Jim Leighton for these images. These were great. Any comments, Jim, about these that we haven't discussed already? Or,
well, this was the vintage race. We, you know, it wasn't a lot of laps. It was right at the end of it. They leveled out the snowcross track and just got made it kind of a type of an oval. You know, just so they could get out. It was really, really mealy. But they had fun with it.
Good.
They had a good time.
Nice. And Rob, any reactions to what we've been looking at here?
Awful brown snow, Jim, but I'm glad they were able to pull it off. A lot of people had to cancel their events, eh?
It was.
Yeah. Was that your 72 kitty cat?
Yes.
Yes, I had one just like that.
Yeah.
I'd be at the races, and I'd run down the canteen, and I would jump in that kitty cat and ride it down. I'm 250 pounds. I used to drive that thing around at the events.
My daughter will put my granddaughter on it, and they ride it around the driveway.
Yep.
Nice.
But didn't go good in deep snow.
No. So that there was a picture there that it was on the lawn. It's a bunch of old snowmobiles. That was my backyard as a kid.
Oh, wow.
Kind of near the beginning of it there.
Let me see if I can find it. Yes, right there.
Yeah.
So that's from back in the day. That was in your backyard.
That's the backyard, yeah. Motorcycles and snowmobiles.
Very nice.
The one all the way to the right, that's that 440 Blizzard that you see that was all restored.
Yes.
And then the other two are 74 TNT 400s, yeah.
Nice.
And the 669 is right next to the Blizzard.
Nice.
I still have the 669.
Very nice. Now, I've got something I wanted to ask both to Rob and Jim, as well as to the viewers. These Polaris Colts, like 76, 77 era, back in the day, I remember those were everywhere, at least where I lived. And rightfully so, because it was an entry-level sled. It was a lot of sled for the money, a lot of value. And they were very, very popular. We saw them everywhere. But the problem I have, and it's not really a problem, but considering how popular and prolific they were back in the day, it's very rare that I see them at shows now. I see them once in a while, but just, you know, one here, one there. Not as for as popular as they were back in the day, you'd think they'd be very common at shows now. So I'm wondering if that's just around here, something that's going on. What are your experiences, Rob and Jim, and anyone viewing?
I found they're only popular in certain areas.
Yeah.
Sure, it was a regional thing.
I went down to the Kingston area, there's a lot of Colts down there. But if I go to the other side of Toronto, hardly anybody had them down there.
Wow. So it's a regional thing, maybe.
Yeah.
I would think so.
Sure. And that's consistent with your experience too, Jim?
Yeah. You know, and funny enough, I'll go back to the mid-90s when, you know, I was a whole lot younger and we used to really raise hell on the snowmobile trails. It was very, very town for town on whether you rode Bombardier, Articat, or Polaris for the most part. If you were in Limestone, there wasn't a whole lot of player snowmobiles on the trail in Limestone that were owned by Limestone people. But when you get to Presque Isle, that was huge, and Articat, you know, it was kind of town for town. It's kind of amazing. So I'm assuming even back then it probably might have been the same way.
Could be.
The same thing worked at my cabin up north. Marina sold Articats, so 90% of the people on the lake had Articats because you'd go down the marina and get parts. You didn't have to take it home.
So it had a lot to do with what dealers were in a specific area.
Yeah.
Sure. Well, cool. Let me take this down, and I want to check the comments because they're coming in hot and heavy. Maybe some other points of view on this too. Let me see. That Clayton show, by the way, is going to be April 20th that they were talking about earlier. James Spranger says, great show, Mike. Thank you so much. And James is out in Wausau, Wisconsin. Ben says, on behalf of all of yours, I would like to thank you and Rob, as well as all of your guests, for an excellent season of Vintage Snowmobile Podcast. This is a tremendous effort to highlight the camaraderie surrounding vintage snowmobiles throughout the U.S. and Canada. Thank you for that. And we do work hard to try to make that happen, for sure. Appreciate that. And then, of course, Rich Shad said he's going to be at that show we were just talking about. Reese Fleury says, great show, guys. Looking forward to next season. Pray for snow. Yes, we're going to need some.
Maybe Reese will come on next year.
Yes, we got to get you on here, Reese. I know you have sleds, and yeah, we've got to make that happen one of these days. John Spranger Jr. says, another great show. Everyone have an awesome summer. Looking to see everyone in the fall. Now, everyone's talking like it's the end of the show, and typically it is, but I'm going to keep going. We've got a few more clips, and it's the season finale, and we're having fun. What the hell? Let's keep going until we've done everything. If you guys are game, I am. Stacy and Art Fosler say it's been a great season to look at. Looking forward to the next snowmobile season. New Hampshire Vintage says, just found this sweet video. Well, thank you. And if this is New Hampshire vintage, whatever you're into in the way of vintage snowmobiles, be in touch with us. And if you do shows or anything like that, send us images, videos. We'd love to share it here for everyone to enjoy. Reese Fleury says they're all rusted bad. Oh, his sleds that he would potentially bring on. Oh, here we go. Stacy and Art Fosler say a 77 Colt SS was his first sled. Midnight Rider says very nice of them to haul the 300 loads of snow in for the vintage race. Mike Whiteside says awesome show, guys. Thank you all so much. Mad Dog says great show tonight. We'll catch you in the fall when you start again. Have a good summer. And oh yes, Bun Thomas says yeehaw, more show. Exactly. It's a season finale. We're going to go out with a bang, right? So with that in mind, this bang that we're speaking of, we've got a few more clips. Let's load them up here. We've got another clip from Midnight Rider, and then we're going to play one of Jim's, and we'll just go back and forth. Yes, another one from Midnight Rider. Let's take a look. Yeah, thank you so much to Midnight Rider for that footage. Reactions to that, Jim? Anything there catch your eye?
Well, I see there's another snowbug there.
Yes.
Yeah. That's, you know, that one up here is the first one I'd ever seen in person. So it's kind of neat to see another one there. Good.
Yeah, for sure.
So, the guy beside it actually brought his living room chair mounted on the snowmobile.
Yeah, how about that? There's two of them. That's the way to travel right there.
Or does that mean the snowmobile doesn't ride very smooth? He had to improve it.
Yes. Yeah, no doubt. On those bombed out trails, that's what you need right there. A nice easy chair. And there was another one here that caught my eye. I wanted to make sure that Rob saw this. Where the heck was it? There was a Polaris with an Amsoil sticker on it. Oh, this Cheetah right here. 72 Cheetah. When I was a kid, we had a 440 just like that. And that sled has everything to do with why I do these podcasts and all the social media stuff today. That sled right there is why I love all this vintage snowmobile stuff. We have wonderful times on that sled, I'll tell you. But I'm trying to find that Polaris with an Amsoil sticker. Oh, right there. I think it was that Colt.
Oh, yeah.
It's kind of blurry, but oh, there it is. Yeah.
Yep.
Sweet, sweet. So, yeah, thank you.
Nice little John Deere there.
Yes.
There's a group of farmers here in town that pretty much bought up every John Deere snowmobile part and piece there was, and they used to trail ride them quite often, but I haven't seen them out in the trails for quite a while. I don't know. They must have them stuck in a barn somewhere, but they had a lot of nice John Deere sleds.
Wow. Very cool. Very cool. So yeah, thank you to Midnight Rider for this. I'm going to take this down. We've got a few more to look at. I'm trying to kind of rush through them here, but let me see. We've got another one from Jim now. It's taking a minute to load. Okay, so this is the one of the people racing at that event. So this is a video clip of those guys racing. Let's take a look. Yeah, good times right there.
Yeah, that was the vintage. Like, I wish I could have got out and got some videos of the race they call the Ditch Bangers class.
Sure.
That was basically mid-90s to early 2000s sleds, and they had them on the snow cross track, and those guys went crazy with those sleds.
Oh, I bet, yeah.
A little more suspension than these, but, you know, nothing compared to the new ones.
Sure, sure. But
It was they were pretty cool racing with that old stuff too.
Nice. Now we've got comments coming in. New Hampshire Vintage says, love to join one day. Let me know. Absolutely. Let's be in touch behind the scenes. And as you've been seeing on here, you know, people send in video clips, as well as still images. And you've probably seen how I put the still images to some music, and it's just something we can all enjoy. So any kind of events you're doing, any kind of events you're going to, just take some images or video. All I ask if you're doing video is hold your camera horizontal like this for a wide shot if you're doing video. It's very difficult to work with vertical footage. And just share that with me, and we'll have it on the podcast here for everyone to enjoy. So Reese Fleury is saying, no, the Colt is rusted. Polaris should have stuck with aluminum. Sure, sure. A lot of those rusted out. New Hampshire Vintage is commenting on the Snowbug. And Midnight Rider says the Snowbug won the rarest sled contest at this Orr, Minnesota show. Very cool. Yeah. Very cool. So, I'm trying to get caught up here where I'm supposed to be. We've got more video clips. All right, here's another one from Midnight Rider. This is from Orr, Minnesota. Thank you. Yeah, thanks again to Midnight Rider for that great footage. Anything catch your eye there, gentlemen?
Well, I seen another one of those Mercury toboggans.
I thought that was yours, Jim.
Yeah.
I've never seen one before. Now we've seen two in one night.
Yeah.
Crazy. Oh, right there. Yes. Now that you mention it. Yes.
It's a nice shape.
And there's a Mercury right next to it.
Yeah. I think there was a couple, there was a snow pony there too. I think I've seen her prints or whatever. The
snow prints. Yeah. Yeah.
Yep. Back the other way.
Yeah.
Don't know what just a glimpse of it.
Anything catch your eye, Rob?
I would give extra points to that cheetah with the stuffed animal on the seat.
Oh, yes.
That's the first time I've seen one of those at a show, which is a good idea.
Yeah.
I did see a guy have his wife dressed up in a cheetah outfit beside it, but that gets extra points for that cat.
Definitely.
Yeah. It also has the purple helmet right there that it's hard to find.
Yes, those metal flake purple helmets from back in the day. Those were very cool. And cool. So let me take this down. We've got one more from Midnight Rider, and then we're going to call it a night. And thank you everyone for all of these images and videos and everything. It just makes it so much fun to see what people are doing all around the snow belt in the way of vintage snowmobile shows, races, events. It's just really fun. And here's the last clip of the night. This is another one from Midnight Rider. This is from a different show, I believe. This is from a show in Warren, Minnesota on March 2nd. So let's take a look. This is also from Midnight Rider. We'll be right back. Yeah, so thank you so much to Midnight Rider. A lot of interesting sleds at that show. Gentlemen, anything catch your eye with that?
A lot of different stuff there.
Yeah, like that so cat right there.
Yeah.
Interesting paint scheme there.
Yeah.
And that cat up further with the red hood open. I don't recall that one neither, but it's in the concept department.
Yeah, right, and that with the pipe off, the Montana pipe hanging off of there. Yeah. And there's like a Polaris mini bike and a lot of interesting stuff there.
Yeah, they're right all in there. Great shape. That must be your friend Jim with all the John Deere's on the trailer.
Yeah.
Yeah, look at that. All those John Deere's.
That's quite the collection.
John Deere's.
Yeah. Well, he had to throw in a Yamaha.
Sure.
That's a pretty cool little mini bike. Of course, that's another thing that I do, and mini bikes and go-karts, vintage stuff.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
You should come down sometime to the Goffstown, New Hampshire show. They've got a vintage snowmobile and mini bike show.
Really?
Every fall. Yeah, every October.
Huh.
If you're curious about it, I can put you in touch with the organizer. It's Bud Gordon. He does organizes a lot of shows in central New Hampshire.
That'd be cool.
Yeah, and if you're curious, let me know, and I can put you in touch with him to, you know, find out dates and information and stuff.
Keep that in mind.
Yeah. And there's another one here I wanted to comment on. There's a Boeski
right
on the end there, right
with
there.
One headlight missing?
Oh, maybe. There's a sign behind it or in front of it. But I've got a memory about a Boeski just like that. I was in elementary school. We were riding home on the school bus one Friday afternoon, and it was October. I remember because the foliage was still on the trees. There wasn't any snow yet. But apparently this guy couldn't wait for snow. As we're driving by on the school bus, he's out in his driveway in the gravel, you know, the gravel driveway doing donuts on a Boeski just like that, right near the road. And we're all cheering him on the school bus going, yeah, baby, you know. We were thoroughly entertained by that. And it looks like he was having a good time too. But I don't know if he did any damage, you know, doing that on a gravel like that. But we sure enjoyed watching him.
Yeah. It's fun to take him out.
Boogie wheels, you'd get away with it.
Right.
Yeah.
Fun to take them out once in a while. I can remember a time I have a 97 MXZ 670. I don't know what got me going. My father was out mowing a lawn, and there's a big long lawn between the two of us. I took that out and I got it running. Listen, he was facing the opposite way, so when I went by him, I was about 3 inches from him going wide open. Obviously, he didn't have a heart attack because he jumped right off the lawn for him. Then I thought, oh my God, I could have given my father a heart attack.
That is funny.
But that's something he would have done to me, so I figured it was fair game.
Yes, absolutely. Well, cool. So, yeah, we've come to the end of the podcast here. I wanted to make a couple of quick comments. I like that we are becoming a place where you can see footage and images from vintage snowmobile events all across the U.S. and Canada. I like that we're becoming more and more the place for people to see that. People send me so much footage, images, and I really like that. And it looks to me like the audience is enjoying it, too. It's a great thing to be known for, you know. So I'm really pleased with that. We've got a few comments coming in, and then we'll get closing comments from each of you. Just trying to find my place here. Okay, so the snowblower. Okay, we did that one. Tim Bewick says, great show. Thank you very much. Ben Thomas says, look on Google for 69 Kaikafer Mercury snowmobile trailer sled sleigh. So that's that sleigh that we were talking about. We can probably find some detail on that. Do a Google search, definitely. Midnight Rider says Rob Grover from Grand Rapids, Minnesota owns the cheetah with the stuffed cheetahs on top of it. He's got a cheetah from every year produced. Also owns a Columbia snowmobile suit in Illinois, he believes. Yeah, if you're in touch with this guy, I'd love to get some video on that. If you're interested in maybe doing an interview with him or put me in touch with him, maybe we can bring him on the podcast. I'd love to see that cheetah collection. I do have a special spot in my heart for cheetahs, as I'm sure a lot of people on here do. Kevin Culhane says, great show, great season. The snowbug was made here in Sudbury, Ontario, back in the day. See you in the fall. And Dave Trim says, no ski-doos. Yeah, I don't think there were any ski-doos at that show. Usually there's plenty of them.
It's true.
Yeah. Midnight Rider says, thank you to Mike and everyone for the awesome podcast and footage this season. Look forward to next year's podcast. Yeah, we're going to have a lot of fun next season. And I like I was saying earlier, I like that we're becoming the place where people send footage and images that I can share on here for all of us to enjoy. And I expect that to just grow even more over the next season. Midnight Rider says, thank you for playing my video clips. I enjoyed sharing. And yeah, thank you so much for sharing them. It's great to see what people are doing all across the Snowbelt. Ben Thomas says, appreciate your sharing your collection, Jim. Thank you again for an excellent show. Yeah, thank you, Jim. That's some great show and tell, both the videos and the in-person stuff in the building there. Glenn Ford says, thank you guys for all you do for the vintage sled community. See you this fall. And Rich Shad says, really enjoying the shows, looking forward to the fall season. And in case this is your first time tonight, not to fear, during the summer months, we're going to have replays every week in this time slot, in this podcast, simulcast to 8 different places across Facebook and YouTube. So wherever you're viewing this right now, circle back here every Thursday night at 9 p.m. Eastern time. We're going to have a replay for you, so you won't be going without through the summer months. Reese Fleury says, thank you, guys. Keep in touch. Absolutely. And, closing comments. Jim, any closing comments before we wrap it up?
Yeah, I'd like to say the same thing. I'd like to say thanks. You guys have done an awesome job with this, you know, Mike putting this together. Rob, every week you're there. And you guys do a hell of a show. I think it just keeps growing and growing. And like you say, these videos, and sometimes, you know, you can't get out and see the collections, but the you know, take some pictures when you're at a show or a video, and what you're doing with them is just as good as, you know, walking around and showing you, kind of like what I did here. You know, I'll never get to Wisconsin to see some of that stuff, or Michigan to see some of that stuff, and vice versa with some of those people come this way, you know. So it's nice to be able to do that, and you guys are instrumental in that. I thank you for that. Keep it going.
Yes, well, thank you so much. Definitely. And Rob,
somebody was mentioning about the poster in my background, Mike. Let me show you the poster. Yeah, this is from a guy that sent me. It's called Blackwoods Snowmobile Rentals, and it's in BC. And the cabins you rent is on stilts, 18 feet high. And he says people rent their snowmobiles off and go up, and they have 10 cabins you can rent. And he says people drive our snowmobiles like they're stolen. And he says that's why we like the Amsoil, because it keeps lasting. So he took this picture and sent it to us, and so we got it blown up and use it at the shows, eh?
Nice. Yeah, hold that up again. I'll put you full screen.
Yeah.
That is nice.
Yeah. He says people drive our snowmobiles like they're stolen because they're rented, eh? He says we know the Amsoil is going to stand up to them.
Nice.
They've been running Amsoil for probably 7 years now, and all the new rental machines.
That's amazing. And then the cabins.
Great
on
show,
tilt.
Mike, and enjoy doing it. And like so many different snowmobiles out there. It's amazing how many different brands and how good a shape people still have them in. It's good to see them.
Yeah, it's nice to see the passion everyone has for this all across the Snowbelt. It's very impressive, you know, from west to east and everywhere in between. There's just a lot of passion for this. And I don't know about where you guys are and everyone else viewing, but Northern Vermont and New Hampshire, it's growing. There's new shows popping up all the time, and all of the shows I go to are very well attended. So I think this thing is on a positive curve, and I couldn't be happier about that. And I'm glad to be part of sharing that, you know, so that people can see what people are doing in other parts of the country. But I wanted to ask you, though, about the cabins on stilts. Is that because they get so much snow to keep it above the snow? Is that what's going on with the stilts?
Yeah. Yeah, they get 28, 29 feet of snow.
Amazing. Yeah. We're in the wrong place.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, maybe.
Yeah, exactly. That might be too much.
That's a lot of snow.
It sure is. Yeah. But, and also I wanted to thank the viewers, because without the viewers, this would not be possible. I mean, Rob and I work really hard on this, and I've got to commend Rob. He's on here each and every week. He's very committed to this. He brings a lot to it, and we thank him so much for that. Season after season, he's here for us, and we appreciate that. Jim's been on many times. Thanks for you as well, Jim. You've come on here several times a year for the last 3 or 4 years, and we really appreciate it. You've always got something great to show people. And, good stuff all around.
I think you should invite me and Mike down for a ride.
Yeah, we should come down to the bowling alley sometime.
Yeah, come on down. We'll have some pizza and bowl and roll around.
Take an Alpine out for a ride.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Anytime.
Absolutely.
Let's make sure there's snow on the ground, though.
Yes, yeah, we got to check first. Good deal. So, been a wonderful season. Thank you so much, everyone, and look forward to catching up with you in the fall. Oh, we've got another comment. Let's take it. Midnight Rider says, I'll be sharing footage from the National Vintage Show in Duluth, Minnesota this August. Yes, please do, because I won't be able to make that, and I would love to see that. Keith Jash says, thank you guys for your time and efforts. Yes, thank you so much for that. We appreciate it. So, yes, this concludes another season. I don't know where it went. It went by so fast, but thank you to everyone. And as always, the last word goes to Amsoil. Have a wonderful summer, everyone, and we'll catch up with you in October.
Great show, Mike, and we enjoy doing it with you.
Thank you so much. Meanwhile,
Yes, I'll be back next year.
And meanwhile, catch the Muscle Car Podcast every Wednesday night.
Can I get my doom buggy on?
Hello, everyone. Yes. This is Rob and Mike. How are you doing today, Rob?
I'm doing good. Mike, yourself?
Very well. Thank you so much for coming on. I appreciate it. Now, today, we're going to be talking about Amsoil. And in a few moments, we're going to show you how you can get the deepest discounts, free shipping, and free gifts when you order your Amsoil products through us. But first, I'm going to ask Rob to give you a quick description of what Amsoil is and why you should consider using Amsoil products in your motorized vehicles.
Thanks, Mike. Amsoil is 100% synthetic oil. Everybody uses Amsoil for a different reason. Some people like the benefits that Amsoil is warranted for 25,000 miles or 1 year. The reason we can do that is because Amsoil doesn't oxidize. It doesn't form the usual carbons, gums, sludges like petroleum oils do. That's why we can keep it in the engines longer. Petroleum oils never do wear out. They oxidize themselves. That's why they have to be changed at 3,000 kilometers. And Amsoil likes the benefit that you only have to change the oil once a year. That saves some money. Some of the people like the benefit of Amsoil is it's a slipperier type lube. By having a slipperier type lube, it cuts down friction drag. By less friction and drag, engines run 20 to 50 degrees cooler, better gas mileage. Now, Amsoil says 25% more protection than the industry requires is in the Amsoil bottles. My average customer gets about 10% increase in gas mileage. That's a big savings.
Yeah.
And by cutting down friction and drag, for every 10 degrees you cut down the friction and drag, doubles the life of the engine. So by having the engine run cooler, it makes it last longer. Some people like the benefit of the range of the Amsoil. Amsoil's flash point is 425 degrees, and it pours at 50 below zero. Wow. If you ever tried petroleum oil when it's 10 below, it turns to the honey. And in the summertime, petroleum oil thins out, and once it thins out, that's when it starts breaking down. So Amsoil is an all-season oil, can give you better gas mileage, longer engine life, less maintenance. It ends up being cheaper over a year's time running Amsoil than it is petroleum oils.
That's amazing. That's amazing. And Amsoil is available for pretty much any motorized vehicle, anything from lawn equipment, cars, trucks, boats, ATVs, motorcycles, snowmobiles.
Yep. And a lot of people phone me up and say, well, what's the benefit of our gear loop? Exactly what I told you about the engine oil. It pours in cold weather. It runs cooler, makes the equipment last longer. And they say, well, what's the benefit of the small engine? Same thing. Makes the engine run cooler, last longer, better performance. So it saves on all the applications that Amsoil has available.
Wonderful. Wonderful. So yeah, let's talk now. Hopefully this has convinced people to think about maybe joining us in the Amsoil experience. Let's talk about some of the discounts and free shipping and how that all happens. I'm going to pop a graphic on the screen. And by all means, if you want to talk people through how this preferred customer program works.
Amsoil has a number of different programs. One of our main ones is a catalog customer, where somebody can order directly out of our catalog. If they order out of the catalog, they order $100 worth, Amsoil will ship it right to their house. But our best program is our preferred customer. For only $10 for 6 months, you become a preferred customer, you save 25% on all the product. You order $100 worth, they're going to give you free shipping. You don't have to order a whole case. You can mix and match. Say you want 4 bottles of small engine, 7 bottles of 5W30, and a couple of gear loops. You can mix and match. You can order 1 bottle at a time if you want. There's no minimums, no maximums. By being a preferred customer, you save over 25% on all the products you're going to buy. Amsoil sends you extra gifts, a $5 gift certificate on your birthday, $5 when you renew your account, and stuff like that. So it's a good way to save on some of the products you want to buy.
For sure, for sure. Yeah, it's an incredible value. And this is the deepest level of discount that anyone can get when ordering Amsoil. Is that correct?
It is. It is.
Wonderful, wonderful. So let's take people through the step-by-step experience of placing an Amsoil order. Then that would include signing up for the preferred customer discount, preferred customer program, so they can receive those deepest levels of discount. So let's go to the website. This is what the website's going to look like. These are some screenshots. Once you go to Amsoil.com, there's a link in the description, or you can just type that into a browser, Amsoil.com. This is the page you land on. At the upper corner of the page there, you see how I've circled in red. That is the link to click, the Join Now link. That will take you to the Preferred Customer Program page, where you can take advantage of all of these discounts and free shipping and everything that we've just been talking about. This is what that page looks like. In the lower right, you're going to click Join Now. This will pop up. You select the duration you'd like, whether it's 6 months or 12 months, and click Add to Cart. Now, once this pop-up goes away, you'll be back on the main page. In the upper left, you'll see where I've got that red arrow. It says Shop. Now you can start shopping for products, and on your very first order, you're going to get these discounts and the free shipping as long as it's over $100. You'll get all of these benefits right away. So once you click shop, it's going to take you to the product page. There's different types of oils, lubricants, so on and so forth. For the benefit of this exercise we're doing now, I'm just going to click motor oil. It shows different types of motor oil. Let's click gasoline. Now this takes us to an item. It's their synthetic motor oil. And you can see the item there, and there's choices for different viscosities. But take a look at the price. Let's take a closer look. Let's zoom in. But if you've joined the preferred customer program first, you're going to automatically get the deepest levels of discount. That's what we're looking at here. You're saving $3.80 on that quart of oil. Instead of paying $16.29, you're now paying $12.49 for that quart of oil. That is the deepest level of discount you can possibly get. And then you just add the quantity that you'd like. You select any other items that you're thinking about, add them to the cart. And once you click add to cart for the final time, you're going to see this come up at the top of the screen. It's going to show your items and the total that you're at so far. Pardon me. And then you just click view cart in the upper right, and that'll take you to your cart. Take a close look here at the upper right. That blue box shows that you're getting free shipping. You're eligible for free shipping on this order because it's over $100. That little yellow box shows that you've got the preferred customer membership on your order that gives you the deepest levels of discounts for the next 6 to 12 months. And then below that, you've got the items that have been selected. For the exercise here, I selected 9 quarts of this signature series, but that brings us up over $100 for the free shipping. We're saving $34.20. And if you're ready to finish, you click checkout now, and that takes you to this screen here. If you haven't signed up with an Amsoil account at this point, just click in the lower right to create a new account. It's going to ask you for some basic information, a name, and those types of things. Now, let's take a closer look. You'll see this gray shaded box. This is a very important box. This is going to ask you if someone has referred you to Amsoil. And if so, please enter my name. My name is Mike LaPierre. It's spelled right there on the screen for the correct spelling. And also the referral number, 304-555-94. That's how you make sure that Rob and I get credit for this. Now, in the interest of full disclosure, I have signed up for Amsoil under Rob. So when you order using this referral number, Rob and I both benefit. So if you enjoy these podcasts that we're doing, this is a wonderful way to support the podcast, because when you order using this referral number, Rob and I both benefit, and the commissions I make go directly toward offsetting the cost of doing these podcasts. So I thank you in advance for that, for using my referral number. I very much appreciate it. And once you've done that, you just go into the next screen to enter your payment information, and you're done. Now, once you've placed your order that's over $100, and that order includes your Amsoil preferred customer program, you are now eligible to get a free DVD from myself. Now, this is going to be either a muscle car DVD or a vintage snowmobile DVD. Use the email address on the screen, wkspodcasts@gmail.com. Send me an email. Let me know which DVD you would like me to send you, the muscle car or the vintage snowmobile DVD, and I'll get that right out to you. As you're typing in that email, in the subject line, be sure and type in capital letters, free DVD requests, so it stands out as I'm checking my email, and we'll get that right out to you. So I guess the last thing, Rob, that we wanted to talk about is if someone is considering Amsoil as a business opportunity.
Yes. If anybody has a retail or a commercial account and they would like to buy directly from Amsoil, just send Mike a line. He'll show you how to set up, and you can buy directly from Amsoil. But if you are interested in starting your own part-time business, a part-time business that can grow into a full-time income, Mike and I will show you the Amsoil marketing plan. Amsoil has a large selection of products that cover almost every application. So it doesn't matter if you're into snowmobile, boating, or ATVing, or hot rods, we have an oil for every application. It's a fun type business that I really enjoy doing. Where else can I go and have fun and make money doing it? And Mike and I are here to help you all the way along. If you need any help on how to promote or to find new accounts, we're here to help you.
For sure, for sure. So when you sign up under that number, this 304-555-94, you're getting Rob and I as a team. Now, Rob has been doing Amsoil for 40 years. Can you believe that? 40 years. So he knows every aspect of this business, and he knows all of the ins and outs of the products. So he'll be able to help you with any kind of product questions or any kind of questions to show you the different business models that you can do with Amsoil. And then the other thing that you get when you sign up under me is I've got a strong background in social media. So if you need some coaching on how to generate Amsoil leads using Facebook and YouTube, I'm happy to coach you with that when you sign up under Rob and I. You get both of us as a team to help you, to coach you, to support you, whatever you need to get you off and running with this business and having fun with it. Like Rob said, it's an enormous amount of fun. If you're like Rob and I and you enjoy going to any kind of boat shows, car shows, motorcycle shows, snowmobile shows, anything with a motor, you like going to those shows, those events, those races, this is a great way to turn that into a income opportunity for you.
Yes, yes. And just by wearing my Amsoil hat at one of these events, people come up and ask me about Amsoil.
Wonderful.
People don't know where to buy it, and I'm there to help them, show them where they can buy the product.
Perfect, perfect. Well, cool. Well, this is great. Any final thoughts, Rob, before we wrap it up?
Amsoil is a fun business. Amsoil has been around since 1968. You know, it was the first synthetic oil to be AI approved.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing. And that's very early in the game too, isn't it?
Yes.
For sure. Well, good. Well, thank you so much, everyone, for viewing. Hopefully we've gotten you excited as we are about the Amsoil products. We'd love it if you could join us either as someone who uses the Amsoil products or to join the Amsoil team as a business opportunity. And we thank you so much for viewing. Have a great day.
You have a good day.